Hey guys, it's Marlene. I've got something new to show you today. Guess what I got? The Leica 100 to 400 millimeter lens for my Lumix G9. This has really raised the bar for my bird photography. And it's all thanks to you, for everyone who has bought me coffees or supported me with YouTube Super Thanks. This lens is for you. I've taken all that money, pooled it together, and got this lens. Now, the extra reach and the extra sharpness of this lens really blows me away. Now, this is not a new lens. It's already about 5 years old at this point, but it's new to me. And if you know me, you know that I don't part with my money very easily. I'm a bit of a cheapskate, actually, and I only buy gear that I actually want to use. So this is definitely a step up for me from my 100 to 300. Now, because of this lens, I also have to carry my camera differently because of the extra weight that comes with getting this big lens. I'll tell you more about that later on in the video. Now, also recently, I've changed a lot of my camera settings, and I'm going to go over all those settings in detail because a lot of you have asked me, what are your settings for birding? And they've sort of evolved over time. And make sure you watch for my bonus tip at the end of this video. Okay, here are my camera settings, and I'll show you everything as we go along. Let's start off with the basics. I shoot large JPEGs with the best quality of the JPEGs. I shoot with the standard photo style with no modifications. I use manual exposure mode, and I choose a shutter speed, usually around 1/1000th of a second. Especially for fast-moving birds, I might go a little bit slower than that, like 1/500th of a second, if the birds are not moving very fast. Like if they're just sitting there, like an eagle sitting on a nest or something. Doesn't need a super fast shutter speed. F-stop, I don't shoot wide open, believe it or not. I like to shoot a little bit closed down. With this lens, the maximum aperture at 400 millimeters is f6.3. I typically shoot around f8 if I'm using 400 millimeters. That way I know I have just a little bit of extra sharpness because when you're using a telephoto lens, you have less depth of field and I want the whole bird to be in focus. I don't want to miss anything. I use auto white balance, usually the auto white balance warm setting on the G9, and I use automatic ISO. And I also keep my eye on how high the ISO is going. I don't really like it going over, like, say, 3200 ISO. Anything over that, it's kind of getting into the mushy zone as far as artifacts go. But again, it depends on the lighting and the situation. And if I'm desperate to get a shot of a bird, I will sacrifice a little bit of ISO to get it. Now, focus is a huge topic, especially for birders. I get so many questions about focus. But right now, here's what I'm using. I basically start off with one area human-animal detection focus for birding. Especially if the birds are sitting in trees, it's a no-brainer. It just works. I've also used it for birds in flight, and I sometimes use tracking for birds in flight. But the one area human-animal detection focus seems to work really well for me. I use autofocus continuous as well, and that's something that I just started doing. I used to use autofocus single shot, but I find that when you're close to the birds, like zoomed in quite far, which you can with this lens, continuous focus makes it just a bit more accurate because the birds are moving around slightly. So even if they're just bobbing their head around or singing and their head's going up and down, you just get a bit of a crisper focus with AF continuous. Now the AF continuous has different customizations that you can use, and I use the set one, which is one of the default settings. Set one, so the sensitivity is at zero, so right in the middle between locked on and responsive. Autofocus area switching sensitivity, I have it +1 on the responsive side. Moving object prediction, also I have it on +1. And the range there is 0 to +2, so right in the middle. If you need more information on autofocus settings, Lumix does have a very extensive autofocus guide, which I will link to in the video description below, but you can also find it on the Panasonic.com website. There's another setting called Focus Release Priority. I use the setting for balance, but you should test out which you prefer because everybody's, you know, got different preferences and ways of shooting, but I like it on the balance setting. The near and far focus settings are something that I've made a video about in the past, but I've recently changed how I have those set up, as well as back button focus. I've talked a lot about back button focus, which I still like to use, but right now I've changed the back button focus to AF far, autofocus far. If you have, say, a yellow bird in a branch like this, and you half press the shutter, it will find that bird if it's in front of the leaves. You don't need any extra special settings for that. That's a pretty easy thing for the camera to find. But what if the bird is behind the leaves or obscured by some branches? Because that's often the case. So I like to set up the AEAF button, which usually corresponds with where your thumb position is. I use that for AF far so that it will jump past those leaves and branches and find the bird in the distance. That is, I find, the most practical way of using that setup because you often don't have much time to think or focus when you're shooting, especially small birds that are skittish and flying around a lot. And I find that with those two settings, it's easy to focus back and forth. Now, the front buttons of the camera, the function 4 and function 5, I have the function 4 as the near button, and the bottom function 5, I've actually changed that to be exposure compensation. Because I find when I'm looking through the lens, I can't seem to locate the exposure compensation button easily without looking at it. If you're doing bird photography and you look away for a second and you look back up, guess what? That bird could be gone. I don't have to remove the camera from my eye to change the exposure compensation. So that's something that's really also a time saver, and it's sort of a workflow thing for me. Also, I find with the AF far button on the back, I find it easier to hold the camera steady. I have small hands and I find it hard sometimes to wrap my hands around to those front function buttons easily. So I find that with it on the back button, it's much steadier and quicker. How about burst modes? Well, I use in the burst shot one setting, I use the setting for high, which is 9 frames per second when you're using the autofocus continuous mode. And that's usually fast enough for me. Sometimes, though, I like to use the super high pre-burst mode, and that's when birds are really skittish and it's hard to predict when or where they're going to fly away. The pre-burst mode gives me a few extra options of capturing the moment. So when I tested out this lens a few months ago, I did have issues with the weight. So Sue H., one of my loyal subscribers, hi Sue, shout out to you, she suggested this Optech neoprene strap, and it's the mirrorless strap, and it is amazing. It is soft and very comfortable around the neck, and I love the fact that it clips on and off really easily. Because I don't always like to use a long strap. I actually like a wrist strap better. But you can't go around on a 7 or 8 kilometer photo walk just carrying the camera in your hand. You have to be hands-free at some point. This strap, very handy, not expensive. I think I paid $27 Canadian at the camera store. And you can get them on, online as well. So even with this strap around your neck, over time, it starts to really hurt your neck. So I've started to carry my camera sideways across my body instead of hanging off the front of me. All right, so here's the camera with the Optech strap. I apologize in advance if I hit the microphone. So as you can see, I can carry it sideways. And And when I'm shooting, I don't take it over my head. I just pull it up and I shoot. So I pull it up and I shoot. And it's just one fast, quick, smooth movement to grab the camera and get it up to my eyes for shooting. It's so comfortable and I'm hands-free. I don't have a lot of weight on my shoulders. If the camera bounces around a lot, I just grab my wrist strap and I just hold on to the camera grip. Say if I'm going up a hill or something and it's, you know, bouncing around. But for the most part, I don't walk super fast when I'm birding. I'm like looking around and walking real slow. And I just find that this way of carrying the camera is super handy. Now, I don't carry a camera bag when I go birding. I just carry the camera. But there's always other things you have to carry. So I just purchased this sweet little 3-liter waste pack from Chrome Industries. And no, they did not give this to me. Although it would be great to get stuff from Chrome Industries. Hint, hint. But anyway, it's 3 liters. It holds like a large water bottle, my keys, my phone, a little snack. And I can even stick my 15mm f1.7 lens in there if I come across any landscapes. Now, you can use this as a waste pack or you can use it as a sling. And even with using it as a sling, there's no interference with the camera itself. Okay, so here's the waste pack. And I'm going to wear, sorry about the microphone, there we go. I'm going to wear the waste pack over my shoulder as well. Now, you can wear it around your waist, but I find that if I have a jacket on, it's kind of like bulky around my waist, and I find this way, carrying it as a sling, to be easier actually and just as comfortable. So I put the backpack on first and then I have the camera on top. And I still have my access, quick access to the camera. Walking along, see some birds, oh! And up I go. It's that simple. So very comfortable setup. I fit enough stuff in this little waste pack that I don't need anything in my pockets. Because, again, if you have a lot of stuff in your pockets, that's not always easy either. I mean, I can put spare batteries and my keys and my phone and everything is hands-free. And I really love that about my new little setup here. Maybe you have a better setup than this. Let me know in the comments what your setup is. I'm curious to see how other people carry this heavy camera or any heavy camera. So if these tips have helped you, let me know in the comments below. And if you have any questions, let me know there as well. And if you'd like to support me and my photography gear situation, you can buy me a coffee or support me with a YouTube super thanks. Great to see you all, and in between videos, I will be posting photos on my community tab in YouTube. Oh yeah, I have one more tip I almost forgot to share, and this comes from Jason Newton. Thank you, Jason. Hi, Jason. What he suggested, if your zoom ring is very stiff, he suggested to grab the lens right behind the built-in lens hood and just pull it. And let me tell you, it goes smooth and quick. None of this cranking. You can just pull it out and be ready to shoot. In fact, you could even have it up to your eye and pull it out, ready to shoot. Now, if for some reason you missed seeing my initial review on the 100 to 400 millimeter lens, take a look at it now.